knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
With two animal phyla covered, it's time to move on to the third. So let's dig into the phylum Placozoa. The name Placozoa comes from the Greek word plax, or plakos, meaning plate, and zoion, meaning animal. So a possible common name for them could be plate animals, which makes sense as they do sort of look like tiny dinner plates. As of 2021, there are only three species in phylum Placozoa, the first of which was discovered in 1883, and the last of which was discovered in 2019. It's possible that since the making of this tutorial, more species of Placozoans have been discovered, or that the phylum has been reclassified with new genera, new families, and even new orders. The evolutionary relationships between the Placozoans and the rest of Kingdom Animalia is still debated. The Placozoans have very few distinguishing features and no regular body shape. They are lacking any kind of symmetry, and at first glance, they can be mistaken for large amoebas. In fact, some of the largest amoebas known, like the multinucleated unicellular Xenophyophoria, are actually 20 times as large, at around 20 centimeters in length, as the largest Placozoans, named Polyplacotoma, which are only 10 millimeters across, and 200 to 400 times larger than the most common Placozoans, Trichoplax, which are 1 millimeter across or less. Their evolutionary relationship to other animals is further complicated by the lack of any fossil record. Traditionally, Placozoans were considered to be a possible link between the sponges and unicellular eukaryotes. According to this hypothesis, Placozoans are the most basal extant animals. This hypothesis was supported in 2006 by an analysis of a Placozoan genome and later by a series of phylogenetic analyses. However, some recent analyses, including a series of analyses performed in 2019 that compared the Placozoans to genomic samplings of most of the other known animal phyla, put the Placozoans as a sister group to the Cnidarians. Placozoans have a number of unique characteristics that continue to fascinate and sometimes confound researchers. They have no symmetry, no organs, and no muscular or nervous systems. Like the Cnidarians and Ctenophores, they have two cellular layers, so they are diploblastic animals. Since the animals are flat, we can split those layers into a top and bottom layer. There is, of course, no such thing as dorsal and ventral in diploblastic animals, since dorsoventral is a characteristic of bilateral symmetric animals. The upper epithelioid layer is made of ciliated cover cells and shiny spheres that function in anti-predator defense, though their precise mechanism of action is still unknown. Their bottom layer is made up of cylinder cells that possess cilia used in locomotion, and gland cells that lack cilia and are used in digestion. Between these layers is an intermediate layer that contains fluid and fiber cells. Most Placozoans are colorless or gray, and they are so thin that they are almost invisible to the naked eye. These entirely marine animals are rarely observed in their natural habitats, though they are often found crawling over substrates in marine aquariums. A single species, Trichoplax adherens, has been collected in bodies of water from the Mediterranean to the Caribbean, to the Great Barrier Reef and the oceans surrounding Japan. They are most common in coastal tidal zones and subtropical areas. In terms of locomotion, Placozoans generally use their cilia to glide across surfaces in a single direction or swim weakly in the water. When they change direction, they do so by changing their shape, much like an amoeba does. Remember that these creatures are asymmetrical. They don't have an anterior end or a posterior end like a bilateral animal. So instead of turning around like you and I would, they simply change shape. Since they don't have muscles or nerves, this movement can sometimes look very sporadic. They've even been recorded splitting in two when different parts of the body start moving in opposite directions. In addition, the direction they move in is entirely random. That is, there is a linear relationship between elapsed time and mean squared distance between their arbitrary starting point and current location, just like the Brownian motion of molecules. However, the speed of their movement, unlike the direction, is non-random. When in areas of very low nutrient density, they move more slowly than when in areas of increased nutrient density. When they are very close to their food source, such as green algae, blue-green bacteria, or detritus, they slow their movements again. When their bodies are over a food source, they form small folds on their bottom side and excrete digestive enzymes into the fold, creating a temporary external pocket, almost like a stomach. The enclosed nutrients are then absorbed. This particular mode of feeding mirrors the so-called placula hypothesis for the origin of metazoan animals. Not all ingested microorganisms are consumed. Sometimes bacterial organelles have been discovered maintaining endosymbiosis within the endoplasmic reticulum of living placozoans. In terms of reproduction, placozoans often reproduce asexually, usually by dividing in two or three approximately equal parts. An interesting thing to note is that since a single placozoan can divide without limit, their lifespan is potentially infinite. They can also bud off spherules of cells from their upper surface, and like all animals, can reproduce sexually under conditions of excessive population density. Placozoans are also capable of extreme regeneration from just a small collection of cells, and can reconstitute their bodies from individual cells. However, this process, along with their phylogeny, sexual reproduction, and endosymbiosis, is still being studied. It is incredible to think that a tiny plate-like organism discovered in an aquarium in Austria in 1883 is still the subject of such incredible discovery.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.